sponsored by Surfshark VPN. Solar panels are a critical technology in our move towards net zero. And even though we're seeing a decrease in silicon-based solar panel costs, we haven't seen significant energy efficiency improvements yet. But what if we could build panels using materials that aren't supply limited, with a more straightforward, lower carbon process, as well as achieving higher efficiencies at the same time? Perovskite solar panels have been promising that future for some time now, but where are they? And are they the future of solar panel technology? Let's explore perovskite solar panels and how they might energize our future. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. Solar power is one of the most promising power sources to reduce carbon emissions. Electricity from photovoltaics into the grid jumped from 597 gigawatt hours in 2005 to about 545 terawatt hours in 2018. And with many policies being rolled out to try to achieve net zero in the next few decades, solar panel use continues to grow around the world. Crystalline silicon has been the go-to choice for decades, and although other materials have popped up, they only cover a small piece of the market, which is about 5%. The main reason for that small market share is because it's hard to make them as efficiently and cheaply as traditional silicon-based solar panels. But silicon isn't perfect. It still has issues regarding cost as well as efficiency, which typically doesn't go above 21 to 22% for those top-selling panels on the market. It's also no secret that making solar panels is a dirty business due to the intense heat that's required to remove impurities from the silicon. So researchers and companies have been looking for cheaper alternatives. And one promising technology that provides simple manufacturing and highly efficient solar panels is perovskite solar cells. Now, perovskites are a family of materials with a particular crystal structure that was discovered by a German scientist, Gustav Rose, when he was traveling in Russia in 1839. Any type of material that has the same crystal structure as calcium titanium oxide is considered a perovskite. But it wasn't until the 1950s that research and development on oxide perovskites grew up, which includes its use in fuel cells, glass ceramics, semiconducting devices, and more. But it was only in 1999 that perovskites started to be applied to solar cells. Researchers from the National Institute of Advanced Industrial Science and Technology from Tokyo announced that they've manufactured an optical absorption layer for a solar cell using a rare earth-based perovskite compound. After that, the new millennium came with extensive research on perovskite solar cells and new fabrication methods and materials. Perovskites are easy to synthesize materials and are considered the future of solar cells since their distinctive structure has shown a great potential for high performance and low production costs. Now, these solar cells have been improved considerably in a short time frame, with a boom in conversion efficiency from reports of about 3% in 2006 to over 29% today, which goes over the maximum efficiency that are achieved by traditional mono and polycrystalline silicon cells. In laboratories, perovskite cells are manufactured by spin coating, spraying, or just painting them onto a substrate, which is a material that provides a surface for chemicals to crystallize on. Now, these cells work much like traditional solar panels, but for a quick recap, the part of a solar panel that absorbs sunlight and converts it into electricity is a wafer made of a semiconductor material, usually silicon. Now, a semiconductor is a material that usually doesn't conduct electricity well, unless it's under the right conditions. Now, this is way oversimplified, but the cell basically has two silicon layers. The top layer has a tiny amount of phosphorus, which has more electrons than silicon. This excess of electrons makes it more negatively charged, so it's referred to as the n-type layer. And the bottom layer has a tiny amount of boron, which has fewer electrons than silicon, to make it more positively charged and known as the p-type layer. When a photon of visible spectrum light hits the panel and is absorbed, it knocks loose an electron while leaving a hole, which is positively charged. The free electron is attached to the negatively charged top layer, while the hole moves down to the positively charged bottom layer. Wires connecting the top and bottom layers create a circuit for the electrons to reconnect with the holes, generating electric current. So why does this matter when we're talking about perovskites? Well, today the mainstream solar technology, silicon, is reaching its practical efficiency limit when used alone. The physicists William Shockley and Hans-Joachim Quasier calculated the theoretical maximum efficiency of silicon single junction solar cells at around 30%. It's known as the Shockley-Quasier limit. Although there are gains made by multi-junction cells that combine multiple layers and techniques together, as I explained in a previous video. Another challenge is that silicon has to be fairly thick and manufactured with very high heat. But when it comes to perovskite solar cells, they don't require the heat and can be manufactured with much thinner layers. They can also work with almost all visible wavelengths, resulting in more efficient transport, recombination, and extraction of charges than silicon cells. Perovskites can be tuned to absorb different colors in the solar spectrum. Now, this bandgap flexibility opens up other useful applications for solar cells in high-performance tandem device configurations that can achieve efficiencies above 30%. They can be combined with other materials like silicon, for example, to form hybrid structures, like those multi-junction cells I mentioned earlier. Each junction or group of layers can be tuned to a different wavelength of light, increasing the overall range of wavelengths the entire cell can absorb, which helps with the efficiency. Perovskites can be produced using very simple solutions that don't require expensive or complex equipment. Its thin film structure has 20 times less material and also doesn't require materials that are uncommon or supply limited. Perovskites are only about half a micron thick, while a silicon layer is around 200 microns. A lifecycle analysis involving several PV technologies concluded that producing silicon cells or perovskite on silicon tandem cells results in both a higher carbon footprint and cost compared to multi-layer perovskite cells. For example, Stanford scientists manufactured thin films of perovskite with a robotic device with two nozzles. The technique may be able to produce perovskite modules for about 25 cents per square foot, while the cost of traditional solar panels range from $4 to $10 per square foot. With better efficiencies, cheaper and easier manufacturing, why aren't we seeing this take over the solar industry? Before I get to that, I'd like to thank Surfshark for sponsoring today's video. I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial targeting and tracking, and a VPN can protect you from that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. One of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up and use on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off plus 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to why we aren't seeing perovskites just take over the industry. The main hurdle for perovskites is whether they can last as long as silicon panels, which generally come with a 25-year warranty and can last much longer than that. Perovskites are very sensitive to oxygen, moisture, and heat, which requires heavy encapsulation to protect the cells, which increases the cost and the weight. The most common electrode material in perovskite solar cells right now is gold, which obviously jacks up the price a little bit more. And cheaper alternatives don't seem to last as long. At warm temperatures, the structures of perovskite cells shift, and although this change is reversible, it degrades the performance of the cell. Although high efficiencies have been achieved, like Oxford PV's perovskite silicon cell, which reached a 29.52% conversion efficiency, most perovskite firms haven't released their stability results. They all said that they follow a certification standard established for silicon solar panels set by the International Electrotechnical Commission, or the IEC. The IEC 612215 standard, which is my favorite of all the standards, it subjects all of the panels to a series of accelerated tests to simulate their operation over years. In one of these tests, the modules are heated up to 85 degrees Celsius for 1,000 hours at a humidity level of 85%, and even bombarded with hailstones. After this heavy and hard series of tests, if silicon panel still works, it's assumed that they have a good chance of lasting 25 years. But in the case of perovskites, even though they could pass these tests, there's still doubts if in practical conditions they will last all those years due to the instabilities compared to silicon. We have decades of silicon use in the real world versus nothing for perovskite. Yet. MicroQuanta's perovskite modules, for example, got the IEC 61215 approval, but it turns out that the modules have their generation capacity reduced to 80% of their initial performance in just 1 to 2 years on average. That's according to field trials from Hangzhou, China. Another small but questionable problem with perovskite cells is their toxicity. Now, lead is used in most common cell structures, and since it's a toxic metal substance, it needs to be carefully controlled from its manufacturing to its recycling. Now, while these challenges still exist, a lot of research and development is being put into making perovskite solar cells a reality. Scientists and companies are working towards increasing efficiency and stability, as well as increasing the lifespan and replacing those toxic materials with safer ones. researchers from the School of Engineering at Brown University have recently published advancements to make perovskite solar cells more durable. They tracked down which of the interfaces was the weakest in perovskites, and then they figured out how to improve their resistance, which was done with a molecular glue. Now, utilizing this molecular glue to glue the cells together, they increased the adherence between the layers of the cells compared to using traditional laboratory adhesives, which could have destroyed the cell's properties. Now, compared to the commercial perovskite cells used in the study, which typically last about 700 hours, the technology developed by the researchers boosted that lifespan to 4,000 hours, which is roughly equivalent to 2 years at 5 peak sun hours a day. That's a massive improvement. But the researchers have identified other areas for improvement as well, so there's still more to come. Today, we only have estimates for perovskite solar cells, and there's not too much real-world use data yet. Estimates show that perovskite solar cells could cost just 10 to 20 cents per watt, but we still need to wait for this technology to be commercialized and mature a little bit to have more of a precise grasp on its true cost and benefits. And regarding their toxicity due to lead, which is very low, by the way, scientists at the Central University of Jharkhand in India have simulated methylonium tin iodide perovskite solar cells optimized with a whole transport layer made of copper oxide. It's a whole bunch of random words. So what does that even mean? Well, the structure they've created is a lead-free perovskite cell. I should have probably just led with that. Their simulations show that it has the potential to reach a power conversion efficiency of 27.43%. And one of the researchers, Vasudev Pradhan, pointed out that the cost estimates are about 8 to 10 times cheaper than standard silicon-based solar panels. Sol Technologies, which is one of the leaders in the perovskite solar cell market, has some really interesting products in the works. They have a perovskite photovoltaic glass that can be integrated into buildings. It's a semi-transparent perovskite solar cell printed onto a flexible foil and overlaid with layers of glass, making a window that generates electricity. Sol is also producing energy harvesting sun blinds that can block intense summer sunlight, but in the mornings and evenings, they allow sunlight to enter the building to provide natural light and passive heating. The blinds can also be adjusted manually or automatically. And the biggest news, in May of 2021, Sol launched the world's first industrial production line of perovskite solar panels in Poland. Jinko Solar, another leader in the solar panel market, is also working on rolling out perovskite technology. In 2017, the company signed a non-exclusive deal with Australia-based Greatcell to commercialize their perovskite cell technology. In its financial statement for the first quarter of 2021, the Chinese manufacturer pointed out, "We have also completed the construction of a high-efficiency, laminated perovskite cell technology platform that is expected to reach a breakthrough cell conversion efficiency of over 30% within a year." So things look like they're finally starting to heat up for the perovskite solar cell market, which is estimated to grow at 34% between 2020 and 2027. But factors such as instabilities and the use of toxic materials could slow down that growth of the market. Now, even though companies such as Sol and Jinko Solar have been investing in this tech, perovskites still have issues to be addressed. But given that the material's efficiency has increased from less than 4% to over 25% within a decade, it's kind of easy to see why so many people are optimistic about the future of perovskites. Even though efficiency can be a great driver, it'll never spur adoption on its own. For that, it's all going to come down to the cost and value, even if it might not last as long as silicon. So what do you think? Is perovskite going to take over the market? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I have linked to right here. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. And as always, thanks to all my patrons for helping to make these videos possible. My patrons get early access, ad-free versions of the videos. There's a private Discord group, and higher-level patrons can join in monthly Zoom calls. Check out the link in the description for more details. But even if you aren't a patron, you're still doing something absolutely awesome just by watching and commenting. Thanks so much, and I'll see you in the next one.